challenge for the students to condense it into a reasonable time frame because they're so excited to share the incredible work that they've done. But they've done a phenomenal job with that. My name is Anita Fernandez, and I'm an education faculty and an RDP, and I also teach in the Masters for Social Justice and Human Rights. I'm based in Tucson, and these beautiful people have been with me all semester in Tucson studying social justice education. So they're quickly going to introduce themselves and then get into it. I'm Ray.
I'm Ted.
I'm
Echo.
Patty.
Jada.
I'm Steph.
Noah.
I'm Rua.
I'm Rebecca.
Renee.
Angela.
So I'm quickly going to tell you about the three courses that the students took over the semester because you're going to hear a lot about them in the presentation. This was three courses. One was a course called Radical Pedagogy, Praxis Along the Border. Radical Pedagogy is the pedagogy used in the former Mexican American Studies program that is now deemed illegal in Tucson. The second course is Race, Power, and Identity in Education, and we melded those two together to make an Uber course with everything to save the world. And then there's another course called Banned Books, Critical Literacy for Social Justice. And in that course, we really took a graduate seminar approach to reading and analyzing several of the banned books in TUSD, all by Chicano and Native authors. And we got to actually interact with some of the authors, which was a beautiful thing. We got to interact with Luis Urrea, who wrote Devil's Highway. He met with us, and we also got to go over to Leslie Silko's house. It was a highlight of the semester, Leslie Martin Silko, and she talked to us about the history of Tucson and some of the ideas about land and time that you'll hear more about as well. And so students got very spoiled. They're like, "Where's Sherman Alexi?" So, yeah. So they got to interact with a lot of different incredible people. So I was one of the instructors. The other instructor with the Uber course was Sean Arce. Sean Arce is the former co-founder and director of the Mexican American Studies program. He is a highly acclaimed Chicano Studies scholar. We all feel like we're missing a limb right now because Shanita's not with us, but his daughter is performing in an international mariachi conference. So you have to pick between his daughter and us. So the students don't know this, but Sean actually recorded a little message for them, so we're going to start with that right now. So Sean can say a few words before we start.
To say that I'm not going to be able to make it tonight, but I know that you are all going to do an outstanding job. You are all blessed me by your intellectuals. It was an honor to work with you this year, this semester. You are all have a real special place in my heart. You all, I see you all as plumas de quetzal, you know, these beautiful quetzal feathers that we spoke about. Indigenous principles, but I know you're going to do an outstanding job and impress the Prescott College community. I love the work that you're doing is groundbreaking, innovative, and really people across the nation are looking at the work that we collectively engage in this semester. So with that, I know you're going to do well in the presentation, so knock it out. Thank you.
That classes start solidarity, to know that there was an event or an issue and that everyone would be in solidarity with by doing this community club, and then they would gather at a meeting, and there were Filipinos and Salvadorians and Mexicanos and all kinds of people with different dialects, and so the community club was a way for everybody to be able to communicate. So in Tucson Unified School District, all the MAS classes were started with the Unity Clap. Bells were like a suggestion, but the Unity Clap was when class really started, right? And so the clap might be before or after the bell, depending on what the community decides on. So the way that the Unity Clap goes is you start really slow, everybody starts clapping slowly, and it gets faster and faster and faster, and at right before the end, the person leading the clap, says, "Iksam Maksak," and everybody tries to clap with the person who's leading. And Iksam Maksak means one down. And that's a Filipino tradition that they actually didn't do in the MAS classes, but Curtis Agosto's Chicano Lit class, which is you'll hear more about, has embedded that into their epistemology now. So that's what we've been doing. So we would love for you all to do that clap with us if you're willing. And you know, Tucson's got rhythm, so Prescott's on.
So one question that we received recently is, why Tucson? Why do an entire semester-long course in another city? Here's an answer. Experiential model of learning that inspires Prescott College's educational philosophies and practices demands that us as students go out into the world and learn by doing. As you'll soon see in a short film that we produced, Tucson has long been a national hotspot for movements surrounding issues regarding social justice education, and specifically Mexican-American studies.
Yeah, so setting these courses in Tucson really allowed us, the students, to have a sense of place and had the opportunity to apply theory and practice on the ground in the community, doing community organizing, bring experts in the area, like on location, and like, really immersing. And it was really important too, because it allowed us to like strengthen the bonds of community that we have there, and all the organizations that we work with. And being in Tucson was absolutely necessary and highly effective for the success of the semester.
And now we'd like to open our presentation with a poem. Another question: why a poem? Here's an answer. One of the main themes of our course was the bridging of worlds and the crossing of borders. And one of the borders that we continually tried to join together was that of our heart and our mind, through and in our work.
Yeah, and poetry was super huge for speaking for everyone on this course. It allowed us to take the complex and like abstract theoretical concepts that we were constantly worrying about, and personalize. And we would like to present to you a poem that we collectively wrote. And it captures our experiences together this semester that we had. And it will be performed in two parts. And this one's going to be the first. And we really hope you enjoy it. And we really, really appreciate you all coming. Thank you so much. Tucson horizon. Warmth begins to ease its way beneath skin.
As the city awakes 500,000 strong, it doesn't take long to realize we're not in orange anymore.
Really?
We're not in Prescott anymore.
Welcome to desolation. This dystopian city in a neoliberal nation.
The desert, a creature all its own. Listen close, and the wind will tell you of a land filled with whispered secrets, demons, and ghosts.
Tucson, Tucson, also the land of banned books, an act of heresy and fallacy designed to knock our kids down and swallow the hot sand.
For a cool taste of American pie, politicians watch as people die to live while they will kill to make. Yet no death on the border ever deemed a politician's career safe. The state controls everything else.
Now they're coming for your mind.
Borders aren't easy to cross and even harder to choose. A border is not to be ignored but understood. Between bodies and borders and resource borders, all of a sudden, none of it matters. In the desert, we are all mad hatters.
Clawing our way through the master hand that weakens us, Adam Smith speaks of us. Because time is an ocean, and we are but
dust.
On the tips of the waves.
When we finally saw our
reflections, it was just for a moment, but it showed us the motive to keep going.
We are awake and on the surface, bound within selves we
didn't know existed, swimming through the cold water with solid purpose.
We learned the strokes and how to float.
Reflection is a process and an intention. Introspection led me to resurrection. The great mixture of talent and practice, theory and action.
Practice!
And if you believe in magic, then what you see comes from what you imagine.
A new door opens, possibilities rush in like the sunset breeze, a rustling of the leaves sigh out as they breathe.
I wonder,
is truth kept in trees? And is it that same truth in me?
I want to grow out of my skin and become anew. I want to prove wrong all those words that you spew.
I want to know the rules of the game. I want to be known by my own chosen name.
I want to feel the earth shift as it spins round. I want to get shit done
before I'm back in the ground.
I want to embark on the journey within. I want to always end.
And begin again. Breathe out to create this art of critical resistance. Step out of subsistence and into the transformative light of the blossom. Shed petals, morph my metals, step off the pedestal.
Jam,
do your bloopers fly. Where do your racist laws ripe as your conscious ride under the brutal desert light?
All politicians are gone.
They'll need new jobs when the new day dawns. These books and teachers are precious.
You can't put a price tag on my education.
But they try to, despite this.
Reflection is a process and an intention. Introspection led me to resurrection. A great mixture of talents and praxis, theory and action.
Praxis!
And if you believe in magic,
doing,
then what you know
comes from what you imagine.
Assembly in Tucson High School to speak about the Sensenbrenner Bill, homophobia, and sexism to the students. During her speech, she said that Republicans hate Latinos. This sparked conservatives and Republicans across the state to try to prove her wrong. and in doing so, proved your statements to be quite true.
The bill the Fuentes just spoke about was H.R. 4437, or the Sensenbrenner Bill, which included border protection, anti-terrorism, and the Illegal Immigration Control Act of 2005. There were protests against H.R. 4437 in major U.S. cities during the spring of 2006.
During this time, Margaret Dugan, a Latina, is Tom Horn's right-hand woman.
April 9th, 2006, a hate group called Border Guardians burns a Mexican flag in front of the Mexican consulate in Tucson.
3 years later, two bills, SB 1108 and SB 1069, are introduced. The first bill allows unlicensed gun owners to carry concealed weapons. The second bill, SB 1069, was the original bill introduced to ban ethnic studies. It will eventually become HB 2281.
The proposal and passage of these two bills inspires a community run to Phoenix in protest.
SB 1070 was passed in 2010. The controversial Show Me Your Papers bill legalizes racial profiling, allowing the state to incarcerate undocumented people in Arizona in ever-increasing numbers. HB 2281 passes with the votes of the passage of SB 1070.
Before leaving the office of State Superintendent of Instruction, Tom Horn, now Arizona's Attorney General, declared that Tucson Unified School District's Mexican American Student Program was a violation of HB 1081.
He had never even set foot in a classroom where Mexican American Studies was taught.
Look at those elected superintendent for the state of Arizona, Tom Horn, and state attorney general.
Who could thaw the new superintendent of instruction commissions cambium audit costing $70,000 in taxpayers' money? The results show that the Mexican American Studies program was highly successful, but who can thaw claims the report is flawed and its results are ignored?
Lupita Garcia becomes the new director of MAS. She was again from the
On April 26, 2011, the TSJ School Board was going to vote to effectively dismantle the Mexican American Studies program. The student group Unido successfully takes over the TSJ Board meeting, preventing the killing of the program. The vote was rescheduled for May 3rd, and despite militarized board meeting security, the vote was canceled again and then rescheduled.
Under threat of losing 10% of their state funding, the Tucson Unified School District Board of Education voted 4-1, ultimately dismantling the Mexican American Studies program on January 10th, 2012. Shortly afterwards, school officials entered classrooms and forced teachers to box up newly banned books in front of all of their students. Tucson Freedom Summer takes place during the summer of 2012, and in early 2013, Prescott College awards college credit for the Curtis Postman's Sunday Chicano Literature class.
Then on March 8th, Judge A. Wallace Machima rules against Arce and Costa, deeming Mexican-American studies illegal in Tucson Unified School District. The case will now be appealed in the United States Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals.
I'm sorry.
first one being theory, the second one being practice, and the third one being praxis. Theory plus action equals praxis. So first we want to talk about what's education like for marginalized youth? What's education like for Tucano youth? If y'all can take a look at this Tucano education pipeline, we can see very clearly that there is something wrong with our education system. It is structured to push marginalized students out, particularly for Tucanos. If you follow 100 Tucano elementary students down through the educational path, about 46 will graduate from high school, 26 will enroll into college, and about 8 will graduate from college. And you can see the rest for yourself. And this is certainly true for Tucson, and especially for TSJES, majority Tucano school district. The Mexican Studies program was structured specifically to intervene in this process. And if you see the part that's highlighted, those are the graduation rates of Mexican American Studies students compared to the rest of TUSD. Consistently over the last 5 years of its running, we're all within the 90%. What exactly is
Bienvenidos! Thank you all for coming. We're super excited at the turnout for the Tucson Social Justice Education Semester presentation. We're so thrilled you're all here. We appreciate you taking some time, this busy moment in your semester. And thank you to all the alum and friends that are on Super Skype thing that you're doing. So thank you. We have so much that we want to share, and it's been such a challenge for the students to condense it into a reasonable time frame, because they're so excited to share the incredible work that they've done. But they've done a phenomenal job with that. My name is Anita Fernandez, and I'm an education faculty in RDP, and I also teach in the Masters for Social Justice and Human Rights. I'm based in Tucson, and these beautiful people have been with me all semester in Tucson studying social justice and education. So they're quickly going to introduce themselves and then we'll get into it. I'm Ray.
I'm Ted.
Adam.
Hey.
Becca.
Patty.
Jada.
I'm Steph.
Noah.
I'm Rua.
I'm Rebecca.
Renee.
Angela.
Right. So I'm quickly going to tell you about the three courses that the students took over the semester, because you're going to hear a lot about them in the presentation. This was three courses. One was a course called Radical Pedagogy, Praxis Along the Border. Radical Pedagogy is the pedagogy used in the former Mexican American Studies program that is now deemed illegal in Tucson. The second course is Race, Power, and Identity in Education, and we melded those two together to make an Uber course with Everything to Save the World. And there's another course called Banned Books, Critical Literacy for Social Justice. And in that course, we really took a graduate seminar approach to reading and analyzing several of the banned books in TUSD, all by Chicano and Native authors. And we got to actually interact with some of the authors, which was a beautiful thing. We got to interact with Luis Urrea, who wrote Devil's Highway. He met with us. And we also got to go over to Leslie Silko's house. It was a highlight of the semester, Leslie Martin Silko. And she talked to us about the history of Tucson and some of the ideas about land and time that you'll hear more about as well. And so students got very spoiled. They're like, "Where's Sherman Alexie?" So, they got to interact with a lot of different incredible people. So I was one of the instructors. The other instructor with the Uber course was Sean Arcet. Sean Arcet is the former co-founder and director of the Mexican American Studies program. He is a highly acclaimed Chicano Studies scholar. We all feel like we're missing a limb right now because Shanita's not with us, but his daughter is performing in an international mariachi conference. So get to pick between his daughter and us and you do something. the students don't know this, but Shauna, should record a little message for them, so we're going to start with that right now. So Shauna can say a few words before we start.
It's unfortunate. I regret to say that I'm not going to be able to make it tonight, but I know that you were all going to do an outstanding job. You were all blessed me by your intellectuals. It was an honor to work with you this year, this semester. You were all have a real special place in my heart. I see you all as plumas de quetzal. You know, these beautiful quetzal feathers that we spoke about within our indigenous principles, but I know you're going to do an outstanding job and impress the Prescott College community. The work that you're doing is groundbreaking, innovative, and really people across the nation are looking at the work that we collectively engage in this semester. So with that, I know you're going to do well in the presentation. So.
Okay, thank you. All right, so one of the other indigenous practices that Sean and Chris Acosta, a number of the MAS teachers who worked with a lot, shared with us in the former MAS classes, embarked on was what's called the Unity Clap. The Unity Clap, some of you may have heard of it before, Precious Knowledge or other places, is a way that classes started and ended. And we'll feel a little joyful here. We don't do that because that's how we're starting and finishing our classes. And so we're hoping that you're willing to participate in that with us. But a little history about Unity Clap. Unity Clap came about during the United Farm Workers Movement. And so it was a way for all of the farm workers across the fields to clap in solidarity, to know that there was an event or issue and that everyone would be in solidarity with by doing this community clap, and then they would gather at a meeting, and there were Filipinos and Salvadorians and Mexicanos and all kinds of people with different dialects, and so the community clap was a way for everybody to be able to communicate. So in Tucson Unified School District, all the MAS classes were started with the community clap. Bells were like a suggestion, but the community clap was when class really started, right? And so the clap might be before or after. So the way that the Unity Clap goes is you start really slow, everybody starts clapping slowly, and it gets faster and faster and faster, and at right before the end, the person leading the clap, if you understand this right, says, "Iksamasak," and everybody tries to clap with the person who's leading it. And "Iksamasak" means one down, and that's a Filipino tradition that they actually didn't do in MAS classes, but Curtis Acosta's Chicano Lit class, which is, you'll hear more about, has embedded that into their epistemology now. So that's what we've been doing. So we would love for you all to do that clap with us, if you're willing. And, you know, Tucson's got rhythm, so Prescott's it. So Costa and I were just in Denver, and I'm sorry, anywhere from Denver? There was some. So we're going to see what the Prescott's going to do, right?
Oh, yeah.
All right.
So one question that we received recently is why Tucson? Why do an entire semester-long course in another city? Here's an answer. Experiential model of learning that inspires Prescott College's educational philosophies and practices demands that us as students go out into the world and learn by doing. As you'll soon see in a short film that we produced, Tucson has long been a national hotspot for movements surrounding issues regarding social justice education. and specifically Mexican-American studies.
Yeah, so studying these courses in Tucson really allowed us, the students, to have a sense of place and had the opportunity to apply theory and practice on the ground in the community, doing community organizing, learning from experts in the area, like on location, and like, really immersing ourselves in the environment. Yeah, and it was really important too because it allowed us to like strengthen the bonds of community that we have there and all the organizations that we work with. And being in Tucson was absolutely necessary and highly effective for the success of the semester.
And now we'd like to open our presentation with a poem. Another question, why a poem? Here's an answer. One of the main themes of our course was the bridging of worlds and the crossing of borders. And one of the borders that we continually try to join together is that of our heart and our mind. Through and in our work.
Yeah, and poetry was super huge for speaking for everyone on this course. It allowed us to take the complex and like abstract theoretical concepts that we were constantly worried about and personalize them. Through creative expression. Yeah. And we would like to present to you a poem that we collectively wrote. And it captures our experiences together. And it will be performed in two parts, and this one's going to be the first. And we really hope you enjoy it, and we really, really appreciate you all coming. Thank you so much. The sun breaks its way above the Tucson horizon. Warmth begins to ease its way beneath.
As the city awakes 500,000 strong, it doesn't take long to realize we're not in Orange anymore.
We're not in Prescott anymore.
Welcome to
desolation.
This dystopian city in a neoliberal nation.
The desert, a creature all its own. Listen close, and the wind will tell you of a land filled with whispered secrets, demons, and ghosts.
Tucson, Tucson. Also the land of banned books, an act of heresy and fallacy designed to knock our kids down and swallow the hot sand.
For a cool taste of American pie, politicians watch as people die to live while they will kill to make. Yet no death on the border ever deemed a politician's career safe. The state controls everything else, and
now they're coming for your mind.
Borders are easy to cross and even harder to choose. A border is not to be ignored.
A border is not to be ignored, but understood.
Between bodies and borders and resource borders, all of a sudden, none of it matters. In the desert, we are all mad hatters.
Clawing our way through the master hand that weakens us, Adam Smith speaks of us. Because time is an ocean, and we are but
dust
on the tips of the waves.
When we finally saw our
reflections, it was just for a moment, but it showed us the motive to keep going.
We are awake and on the surface, bound within selves we
didn't know existed. Swimming through the cold water with solid purpose,
we learned the strokes and how to float. Reflection is a process and an intention. Introspection led me to resurrection. The great mixture of talent and practice, theory and action.
Practice!
And if you believe in magic,
do we?
Then what you see comes from what you imagine.
A new door opens, possibilities rush in like sunset breeze, a rustling of the leaves sigh out as they breathe.
I wonder,
is truth kept in trees? And is this that same truth in me?
I want to grow out of my skin and become anew. I want to prove wrong all those words that used to do.
I want to know the rules of the game. I want to be known by my own chosen name.
I want to feel the earth shift as it spins round. I want to get shit done
before I'm back in the ground.
I want to embark on the journey within. I want to always end.
And begin again. Breathe out to create this art of critical resistance. Step out of subsistence and into the transformative light of the blossom. Shed petals, morph my metals, step off the pedestal.
Jam, remember,
do your bluebirds fly. Part of your racist laws, right? As your conscious ride under the brutal desert light.
All politicians are gone.
They'll need new jobs when the new day dawns. These books and teachers are precious.
You can't put a price tag on my education.
But they try to, despite this.
Reflection is a process and an intention. Introspection led me to resurrection. The great mixture of talents and praxis, theory and action.
Praxis!
And if you believe in magic,
doing,
then what you know
comes from what you imagine.
In Tucson High School to speak about the Sensen Brenner Bill, homophobia, and sexism to the students. During her speech, she said that Republicans hate Latinos. This sparked conservatives and Republicans across the state to try to prove her wrong, and in doing so, proved her statements to be quite true.
The bill Quinn just spoke about was H.R. 4437, or the Sensen Brenner Bill, which included border protection, anti-terrorism, and the Illegal Immigration Control Act of 2005. There were protests against H.R. 4437 in major U.S. cities during the spring of 2006.
During this time, Margaret Dugan, a Latina, is Tom Horn's right-hand woman.
April 9th, 2006, a hate group called Border Guardians burns a Mexican flag in front of the Mexican consulate in Tucson.
3 years later, two bills, SB 1108 and SB 1069, are introduced. The first bill allows unlicensed gun owners to carry concealed weapons. The second bill, SB 1069, was the original bill introduced to ban ethnic studies. It will eventually become HB 2281.
The proposal and passage of these two bills inspires a community run to Phoenix in protest.
SB 1070 was passed in 2010. The controversial Show Me Your Papers bill legalizes racial profiling, allowing the state to incarcerate undocumented people in Arizona in ever-increasing numbers. HB 2281 passes within months of the passage of SB 1070.
Before leaving the office of State Superintendent of Instruction, Tom Horn, now Arizona's Attorney General, declared that Tucson Unified School District's Mexican-American students program was a violation of HB 2281.
He had never even set foot in a classroom where Mexican-American studies was taught.
Look at those like a superintendent for the state of Arizona, Tom Horn, and state attorney general.
Bukathal, the new superintendent of instruction, commissions cambium audit costing $70,000 in taxpayers' money. The results show that the Mexican-American Studies program was highly successful, but Bukathal claims the report is flawed, and its results are ignored.
The Peter Garcia becomes the new director of MAS. She was again the Mexican-American
On April 26, 2011, The TSJES School Board is going to vote to effectively dismantle the Mexican American Studies program. Student group Unido successfully takes over the TSJES Board meeting, preventing the killing of the program. The vote was rescheduled for May 3rd, and despite militarized board meeting security, the vote was canceled again and then rescheduled.
Under threat of losing 10% of their state funding, the Tucson Unified School District Board of Education voted 4-1, ultimately dismantling the Mexican American Studies program on January 10, 2012. Shortly afterwards, school officials entered classrooms and forced teachers to box up newly banned books in front of all of their students. Tucson Freedom Summer takes place during the summer of 2012. And in early 2013, Prescott College awards college credit for the greatest books by Sunday Chicano Literature class.
Then on March 8, Judge A. Wallace Machima rules against Arce and Costa, deeming Mexican American studies illegal in Tucson Unified School District. The case will now be appealed in the United States Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals.
What do we do?
Do such an incredible job at helping
achievement gap between and boost graduation rates for all good students.
So like Raquel said, this first section we're going to be talking about theory, and we really wanted to share some of the theory that we read in this class, as well as a lot of the theory that provided the framework for the Mexican American Studies program. And we're going to start with a quote from Frere. It says, "Our capacity to live free requires a fundamental shift in how teachers and students define themselves and the conditions in which we exist." So what these theories helped to do was to help us understand the conditions in which we exist and how our identities are shaped within those conditions and how we can engage with these systems to change them. So we read such theorists and thinkers as Yolanda Chavez Leyva, Heriberto Godina, and many more. Also, the framework of the Mexican American Studies program was formed around critical race theory and Latino critical race theories, Latino critical race theory comes out of critical race theory and addresses issues such as language, immigration, culture, and identity. So there is five basic principles of what a critical race theory framework looks like in education, and one of them is the centrality of experiential knowledge. And so here are two of the books that were banned in the Tucson Unified School District, and these sort of books are really important to have in these classes because they tell the story of marginalized perspectives. They touch on issues such as race, class, poverty, immigration, the complexities of identity, and were really important in helping the students to see themselves reflected in the curriculum and to understand that they are important. Another one is the challenge to dominant ideology, traditional claims of the educational system to objectivity, meritocracy, colorblindness, race neutrality, and equal opportunity. So basically, what this is doing is challenging our common sense ideas that we have about what education is and what purposes it serves and what schooling should do and can do. Another one is the centrality of race and racism and intersectionality with other forms of subordination. So a lot of these themes overlap and work with each other. And these classes, the Mexican-American Studies classes, as well as within our class, work to address issues of intersectionality and understanding the ways in which we take on, or we have multiple identities that work differently within these systems, and understanding what that looks like. Another perspective is the interdisciplinary perspective. And this helps to place students and the experiences that they're experiencing within a historical context. Whereas normally we like to think of time as moving in a linear path, and like the things that happened in the past are in the past and they don't affect what's happening now or dictate any of our experiences at these current moments. And this perspective helps the students to understand that the experiences that they're experiencing come from a legacy of events and experiences. And finally is a commitment to social justice. These classes, as well as our class, work to engage students in wanting to engage with their communities and working towards social justice. And so the critical race theory and Latino critical race theory, as well as a lot of the other theorists we've read, were crucial to the framing of the Mexican-American Studies program, as well as the indigenous epistemologies, which Raquel's going to talk about now.
So another important piece in the Mexican-American Studies program was a big part about reclaiming and also living by Chicano and indigenous mindsets. And one great example of this is the concept of Imagets. Imagets is a Mayan saying, and it's also the principal philosophy that the Mexican-American Studies program is based on. And in fact, most of the Mexican-American Studies classes have the students repeat this to themselves and their neighbors at the start of each class.
This particular version of it, so in my catch means literally you are my enemy. This particular writing of it comes from a playwright named Valdez. In the French, the saying goes, "Tu eres mi autor, yo me he daba daño a ti, I did harm to you, me hago daño a mí mismo, I did harm to myself. Si te amo y respeto, I love and respect you, me amo y respeto yo, I love and respect myself." This was the guiding principle and philosophy of the Mexican American Studies classes, and this would really set the stage for exactly why these students are learning what they are. This next one you might recognize this as the Aztec calendar. If you're Chicano, this is probably at your mom's house or something. You'll notice up at the center of this the face of this calendar right here, you'll see four little images surrounding it. These are particular manifestations of what are called the Nahuatl, which is the four movements. The Nahuatl was a very important structuring of philosophy and structuring of the Mexican American Studies classes that were also repeated constantly throughout the courses and also during our course. This is a novel concept, particularly related to the process of human transformation. There are four energies and movements that take part in this. The first one is Tezcatlipoca, which means smoke and mirror. And this is the movement of self-reflection. Tupac Acosta from describes this as a self-reflection that reconciles history with the possibilities of the future. This is a very very deep and vigorous searching and reflection inside itself in order to learn something and to help begin the process of transformation. The second is Quetzalcoatl, the feathered serpent, and this is beautiful and precious knowledge. Quetzalcoatl particularly talks a lot about the constant testing, but testing by time of precepts and the perceptions of the world are growing and evolving constantly. The knowledge that we gain from our past and from our present, this is something that gives us stability and a direction. The next energy, Uxiopochtli, hummingbirds to the left. This is the movement of will to act. In particular, this is about the energy and exerting the physical strength or the physical effort to create positive and progressive change. The exertion of this energy eventually becomes a discipline, and this is incredibly important. The final of these energies is Shikatote, which is transformation. This transformation is something, it's very much about shedding a pieces of ourselves that hinder us and having the strength to embrace something new for our lives. These four energies again, Tezcatlipoca, self-reflection, Quetzalcoatl, beautiful and precious knowledge, Huitzilopochtli, the will to act, and Xicotote, transformation. These four energies are essential for each human and each community to go through, and the Mexican American Studies classes and our paths are very intentionally structured at facilitating this process of growth and positive transformation, specifically to change the world.
So Nahuatlin and Mihakesh are really great examples of how the Mexican American Studies teachers use indigenous epistemologies to show their students inside their curriculums. And when students can see themselves in their curriculums, they also begin to see themselves as historical beings. Angela Berger said that our critical understanding of history and human beings as historical beings is fundamental to any revolutionary teaching practice. yet teachers have traditionally been educated to think of history in a frozen and fixed manner. When we are redefining history for our students, we need to think that students need to see themselves represented inside of their curriculums. They need to begin to understand that history is not stagnant and that they are historical beings, thus being agents of change. The majority of curriculums that we see in our schools today tell one-sided stagnant history, and in these histories, few students are represented. One of the most popular examples of this is the Christopher Columbus as discoverer myth. This myth is often told through a European white perspective. It's a single side of a very complex history. The Christopher Columbus as discoverer myth hides the fact that even though Christopher Columbus's ship sailed the seas hundreds of years ago, many marginalized groups still feel the effects of his voyage. The Mexican American Studies program successfully used multi-layered histories in their classrooms. They were able to focus the stories and histories in their classrooms around the Chicano perspective. This helped the Mexican American Studies students see themselves within the curriculum. They began to see themselves as historical beings, and they began to act as agents of change. An example of this is the Chicano Studies walkouts that have happened in the United States. 45 years ago, in 1968, this picture on top, students walked out of schools in LA, protesting for fair education. They wanted Chicano Studies classes. And in 2012, Tucson history repeat itself in Tucson. All of these students here are walking out of their classrooms responding to the ban of the Mexican American Studies classes. They're acting as agents of change. In this picture, in both pictures, students are changing history. In order for students to realize their full potential, we must create safe and caring spaces within our classrooms. Safe spaces are places where students can be vulnerable and raw with their classmates and their teachers. Curtis Acosta said that the lives of our students outside of the school gates are largely marginalized and ignored in their daily school experiences. This lack of empathy, commitment, and love within school halls and classroom spaces creates distrust, cynicism, and disengagement. To start showing love, empathy, and commitment to our students, we need to begin redefining our classroom spaces. We need to begin authentically caring instead of aesthetically caring. Angela Venezuela says that teachers who aesthetically care expect students to demonstrate caring aesthetically. She goes on to say that from these adults or teachers' perspectives, the way youth dress, talk, and generally deport themselves prove that they do not care about school. All in all, aesthetic caring is based on stereotypes, and unfortunately, these stereotypes are often applied to the students inside of our classrooms, especially students that challenge the dominant narrative. Authentically caring looks much different than aesthetically caring. Authentic caring begins with the basic needs of all humans. This is Maslow's hierarchy of needs, and as we can see, first we must meet the basic needs of anyone before anything else can build on top. Basic needs must be met for students to feel safe and able inside of their classrooms. In other words, if students are hungry, we should be bringing food into our classrooms every single day. Overall, students need to be seen as whole people. Their entire identities need to be seen within the classrooms. Educators cannot address one side of history or a single dominant identity. Students should be seen as whole beings, historical beings in their classrooms. Only by doing this can we start redefining history and our educational spaces.
So these different theories of authentic caring and incorporating indigenous epistemologies and frameworks into the classroom work to cater to the needs of the students and the community rather than the students having to come into the classroom and try and fit into these ideologies and ideas that don't reflect their experiences and don't reflect what they need to be able to engage with creating a safer space for themselves. So what we should do, these theories and thinkers help to shape the
in studies, but it's not the end. And so we're going to end with another fairy quote, which says, without practice, theory runs the risk of wasting time, of diminishing its validity, as well as the possibility of remaking itself. In the final analysis, theory and practice in the relationship become necessary as they complement each other. So now we're going to talk about some of the practice that comes along with the knowledge that we gain from this theory.
Talking about some of the practices and pedagogy that were both implemented in MA's classrooms and in our classroom during the semester. And I'm going to start us off here with a poem that I wrote this week in dedication to all the beautiful poetry that my classmates are constantly sharing in the classroom, and also as part of my own personal practice that I've been going through as I transform the semester. So, now listen up! And pay attention. Did your high school English teacher ever mention a word named hegemony? A system of social control in which we are all complicit. Maintained by the superstructural forces of society and in newspapers, on the television, in our schools. Easily. It's like the elimination of bilingual education, the never-neutral high-stakes testing, the overabundance of surveillance resulting in the overabundance of arresting. In other words, young arresting students of color, young people who are too often denied access to an education with a culturally relevant curriculum. In other words, their stories, our stories. Hegemony speaks itself in a storytelling manner, and for those who reveal themselves as the forces of this hegemony, they operate under a hateful, racist, neoliberal banner. And yet, as we are indoctrinated with their stories, we must learn to tell our own. We are the teachers and the students. Do all of that be known. You'll notice in one line of my poem, I accused all those politicians up there as being racist, right? So this is a label that they would never accept themselves. If I were to like go up to them in public, you're racist, they'd be like, no. So this naming process of being able to see what's in the world and name it is part of a pedagogy we call critical literacy, which could be defined as learning to read and write as part of the process of becoming conscious of one's experience as historically constructed in specific power religions. So during our semester, we read a lot of the banned literature and we wrote our own stories. But in addition to reading those stories, we're also reading the world around us and the context in which these stories were banned. And we're writing our own stories, but we're also like expressing ourselves in the context in which these stories came to be. So critical literacy, we use really to start making sense of the world in which we live. And once we start making sense of it more, once we really start seeing it, we can start critiquing it and start enacting change upon it. And so as we're practicing our critical literacy skills, we had the amazing opportunity to work with Curtis Acosta's Sunday Chicano Literature class. The acronym class stands for Chicano Literature in Sunday School. And in this class, Curtis Acosta uses the same exact pedagogy that he used in TUSD classrooms before his curriculum was banned. And this is a curriculum that is proven to increase the success of students of color. So as TUSD shut down this program just a while ago, this year, Prescott College started offering college credit to these students who take these classes, which is a very significant win, and everyone here should be proud of our institution for doing it. They're still accepting donations for tuition for next year's classes, and also they'll be attending a summit in Chicago this summer called Free Minds, Free People, where they will be presenting. So I think there's a link in our zine, so if you're interested in supporting them and finding out more, you should definitely do that. And finally, I thought I'd close this off with a quote from James Baldwin, and we read this piece of Talk to Teachers early in the semester, and it really sums up very well at why critical literacy is needed in the classroom. So he said, the purpose of education, finally, is to create in a person the ability to look at the world for himself. What society is really ideally want is a citizenry which will simply obey the rules of society. The obligation of anyone who thinks of himself, herself, themselves as responsible is to examine society and to try to change it and to fight it, at no matter what risk. This is the only hope society has. This is the only way society has changed.
Did you hear that? James Baldwin says, if we can consider ourselves responsible, then we must silence. That we must examine the structures to try to change it and to fight it. So examine it well. Welcome to the way that knowledge works in the majority of K-12 and higher education classrooms nationwide. Let me break it down for you. Okay, at the top, we have the object. This object of which someone, yes, most likely a white privileged male, studies excessively for an extensive period of time.
Yes,
expert, PhD expert, went for this expert, tells, gives, shoves information unto his minions, the amateurs, ignorant children, empty brains, to bathe with plentiful exigent truth. Yikes. But seriously, this is precisely how so much of dominant narrative knowledge is imposed upon us every day. It is how politicians address their constituents, how parents treat their kids, how classroom space is dictated. Who gets to be these experts? Who gets to choose what knowledge? You saw the chart before. The Chicano education pipeline says that only 8 out of 100 Chicano students maybe this opportunity. Maybe. We're not satisfied. We examined it. We're not satisfied with the state of public education. So now, let's change it and fight it. How did we reimagine, reinvent, complexify, and rectify our classroom space? We started an aero farm! Now that's silly. That is silly. But seriously, what all these eras represent are the multiplicity of identities and historical factors that come from so many angles to create a living body of truth. Through the lens of critical literacy, we can interpret this slide to represent the collision of words and worlds. In this collision of our personal identity, theory, and written narratives, that our classroom becomes an ultimate practice space, a living and breathing fluid continuum of knowledge. With the intersection of these three factors, personal, interpersonal, and political, we can begin to understand struggle against oppression in the U.S., and we can start to imagine how this can be addressed within ourselves and the greater context. One way we began to incorporate many narratives into the classroom was through storytelling.
In order to combat the hegemony of the dominant narrative, it is necessary for us to utilize the practice of storytelling. In order to combat the hegemony of the dominant narrative, it is necessary for us to hear the counter stories, which tell stories of people who have been pushed to the margins of society. In hearing these stories, they are validated as being vital to our understanding of history and reality in general.
We brought this into our classroom through the practice of remembering and sharing. Remembering our history and sharing our identities. We did this in class by writing four narratives through the framework of the Now We Olim that Raquel talked about earlier. By bringing our histories and lived experiences into the classroom, we began the process of naming ourselves, putting a narrative to our experiences. 15 beautiful experiences, including our teachers. This contextualization helped us both define our place within the struggle against oppressive forces and define our humanity. In our papers, we were asked to bring the I, the me, and the we narratives back into our space as they're from where they were vanished in high school. This brought heart and emotion into the space in a beautiful, zesty cauldron of swirling narratives, self-reflection, and critical energy.
Stories, and history in particular, can cause harm or be used for healing. When your history is
was done in TUSD to Mexican American history, it can leave you and your community with long-lasting emotional, physical, and mental effects that keep you living in the trauma of your past. When you engage in the process of learning your history, it can be incredibly healing, as was demonstrated in the MAS class, in the MAS program, and in our class. Chicano scholar Yolanda Chavez Leyva calls this process una gran limpia, or great cleansing, where the body, mind, and spirit are brought into balance, as the negative is washed away and replaced with that which is healthy. As we can see from the fate of the MAS program, as well as looking at possibly your own education and definitely the majority of public schools in the U.S., the purely colonial narratives are being used to justify and perpetuate unequal power relations. This justification is reflected in the banking method that was shown earlier. Another way of counteracting these non-inclusive narratives is through hip-hop. Hip-hop is a form of storytelling that has been particularly impactful to our class. It is a type of storytelling that conveys messages with exceptionally intense feeling and has a history of telling stories of marginalized people. Hip-hop is also an effective form of storytelling because of its popularity and the immense amount of social and cultural capital wielded by the hip-hop artists. Foremost, a method of self-expression. We have seen hip-hop used to reclaim history. It allows the artists to acknowledge and honor themselves, their culture, their history, and to envision a new future. Olmeca, one of the hip-hop artists that we met with, shared with us his experience of this and how he uses hip-hop to share his story with the world to transform it. We're now going to show you a clip of his video and song, Pieces of Me.
It's just the opposite. Loving men who put problems on people in my surroundings. Our biggest obstacle was lack of education and poverty. Forced to do what was needed, forbidden order to kill me. It's hard to see the warmth of my family's love turned into a cold hug. Cause the money problems are resolved. Two jobs ain't enough, still they grind harder than most. I'm pissed off at the world because we're now given no choice. Get here. Our folks first started their country. You must be crazy. No one crosses the desert because they want to. It's a necessity, a sacrifice for the family. You don't call them illegals, you call them economic refugees. This part of the song, I would tell you, imagine how you felt. But I know you don't need to imagine. Because if you've been poor, then you know the feeling real to you and vivid. Because you felt it. Taste it, smelt it. In other words, you also lived it.
So what the effect is? What did our brother Almeca do in 1 minute of his hip-hop piece, Pieces of Me? In 1 minute, he brought in the intersection of his identities, his family, go back there, his family and his land. He asks us both to engage in asking ourselves, how did we get here? And challenges us to rethink the naming of immigrants as illegals, economic refugees, a counter-narrative, a humanizing narrative all on his own. And at the end, he gives us a shout-out to our lived experiences. You've also lived it. Only art can save us, said fellow activist Tony Diaz that first week of class. Olmeca's words are a beautiful practice of using the art of liberating lyrics to find his humanity and share it. We engage in the practice of occupying space and listening to the counter-histories that exist there as we spend time on the land and with some of the historians, or gente, that have lived on these lands for centuries. The first practice in moving toward deconstructing the history of a place is understanding the history of the land. As Arizona has been painted red, white, and blue, and red all over again by the political lines and storylines that define its national image, a different story is held in the landscape. Tucson, or de-Anglicanized,
led by undocumented students whose mission was to make higher education accessible to other undocumented students, as well as providing resources for their families.
Really incredible.
So, Tay Byers, student to graduate, is going to be here's a quote from him on his experiences with the organization and thoughts on it. Scholarships A to Z was wonderful because it was clearly led by the people it was aiming to serve. At the meetings we went to, there was obviously a critical analysis of the social structures they were existing in. At the Pima Community College Board meeting, which is what that previous picture was, they used their analysis as well as months of work researching, mobilizing people and resources to create positive structural change in their community. So another thing that I want to touch on is how...
involved.
summer brings home. Okay. So, you still may be asking yourself, what does all this mean? We've been seeing all these beautiful practices in our community down in Tucson, outside in Nogales, in LA, this praxis everywhere. But where it really had to start, where this foundational layer had to be laid, was in our classroom. And so, what I'm going to talk to you about is this thing called critical community. In our classrooms, we... Alright, so, critical community. You see this word underneath it, and you may be being like, okay, what the heck? But that actually is a conscientización. It's a principle of Freire's that basically means the cultivation of a conscious or a critically conscious mind. And so what critical community really is the cultivation of that collectively. As we build critical community and attempt to peel back the veneer of dominant society, we begin to view the reality of our systems and structures. It is engaging with this reality, with the motivation of love and the promoting of a critical consciousness that characterizes a critical community. This is a community that works in praxis for liberation at all times. The real reason why MAS was so successful is because they work to engage this critical community and empower their students as agents of change. Give them the support they needed to work in the world around them. Okay, so this is a quote from Freire that really characterizes critical community and gives you another perspective on another aspect that's extremely important. To begin anew, to make, to reconstruct, and to not spoil, to refuse to bureaucratize the mind, to understand and to live as a process, live to become. So what does that mean? It means that you never stop. As soon as critical community becomes instilled, you can't stop, because it's a process of liberation that is ongoing, it's a life. Okay, and so one other thing I want to instill before we get into this, which is the methodology that we use to learn this critical community and create it within our classroom, is that praxis, this creation of this community, is really the culmination of everything, like theory, practice, everything that was laid down in our class came into this space where we were able to weave ourselves together into like a beautiful seed and grow something that was going to change the world, that people could see. And what we want to do all the time is extend that to community as far as we possibly can. And so the way that we worked with this community and the way that we created this was through the epistemological framework of the now we mean. And so I'm just going to go real quick through them. We start with reflection, the smoking mirror. This leads to beautiful and precious knowledge. You glean it within yourself. From this, you gain the will to act through the realization of this knowledge, realizing that you can change the world. As this happens, you come to self and community transformation. And what I want to really say about this is that it's not just four stages that you do individually. There's no beginning and there's no end. It's a continuation that happens forever. And it happened within our minds, it happened within our classroom, our hearts, in the community around us, and all those things interrelated, it happened as well. And so, something I want to show is that this never stopped for us. When we were in the classroom, when we were out in the community viewing murals that were done in the same mindset, when we were in LA, we were having classes in, you know, coffee shops, when this is us getting a guerrilla theater workshop from Mark Benante just one day. And this is us Skyping in, as we did many, many days. It seems like on the daily, we were Skyping in with some amazing person who was just blowing our minds. So this is Tony Diaz, the founder of start here and then move other places. Ethnic studies has been banned here, and we're fighting this. Because we know there has already been legislation attempted to be passed in Texas and in other states. All of our laws here, they move, okay? So we know if we can stop the destruction of ethnic studies here, then we can keep ethnic studies in our country and keep these stories alive. What we did in this document was compile all these different resources and history, and we sent it out to all of our allies to try to combine us, ban us under one banner, a national organization, so that we can fight this and keep these things alive. Personally, something that was really beautiful about this whole document was each section required a huge amount of creativity and imagination. Not only did we need an intense analysis to know how to do this, along with our practice, which culminated into our praxis, but we needed to imagine things. Personally, Renee and I worked on a section called the logic model, where we were allowed. We were given the extreme and beautiful opportunity to imagine a future for this movement. And we weren't only given this opportunity to imagine a couple of years in the future, but we were asked to imagine what does our world look like, even past the saving, or like the fighting for ethnic studies, this ongoing struggle. And so we really want to bring it back to asking y'all a question, which is, what can we imagine? As a Prescott College community, as a community in Arizona, as a community in your classrooms, but even more immediately and directly, as a community with your friends and family, the people you hang out the most, like, what can you imagine? What are you willing to struggle for? And what are we willing to engage, and who are we willing to engage with?
Yeah, when you imagine liberation, what do you see? When you imagine community, what do you see? And also more importantly, equally importantly, are you willing to do the work to create what you imagine into a reality?
We work with so many really great organizations. We've seen it in our reading. We've observed it every day while down in Tucson, like how one idea can spring this self-reflection, this action, all these things that culminate, that can lead to such amazing change where people can really get stuff done and start creating the world that they want to see. So we just open that up to you all.
Heart lies in all spaces, the margins and the depths, those places we thought could not exist.
We're on the brink of something new. See, we're a crew of zanies and fools who don't believe in sensible rules. Yes, the impossible is possible as long as you're cool.
Understanding, maybe all hate wants is a sense of belonging. Maybe those who hate are just lacking in love. Was it Autumn who said Tom Horn just needs a damn hug?
this.
We're gonna rise up and have fun with it because we're in it for the long term.
Choosing a history that always exists in my heart and yours, it always persists.
Freedom.
That was a language they were never permitted to speak. Nevertheless, they opened up their mouths and the sound beat out the same rhythms her heart drums to. They said, we were
orchestrated by our own composer.
And the children of the future have grown and chosen
no fear.
It's bigger than this. Layers of analysis. One on top of the other, slowly shedding the skin off.
Shoulders.
Knuckles.
Neck.
Growing. New eyes and ears amid eager to be seen and hearing. Strength is present.
Power
is building.
He asks us to choose a side of the past. We've chosen the path that's proven to last.
The heart and the soul.
Hummingbird wings that can shatter the mind and ideas that can't keep up with our time. Our truths.
Spoken.
Read.
Written.
Felt.
Leading to liberation so graceful and real that nothing can disrupt us.
Fist up!
The songs of freedom ring out from their knuckles like 100 years before and since, swimming the way mermaids or sea goddesses do throughout time and space, abolishing the myth of linearity.
Reflection is a process and an intention.
Introspection led us to resurrection.
The great mixture of talents and practice, theory and action.
Praxis.
And if you believe in magic,
we do!